raise awareness.
There's one question on the policy, sir, which says that allowing foreign universities to start their branches in India, and what would be therefore the impact on, you know, underprivileged sections? I think it's a question about the policy. You'd like to answer, or we'll move on to the next one.
Professor Hargopal?
The corporate is very powerful. You see, I mean, corporate today is the policy maker. The government is only, you know, I mean, endorsing what policies, you know, they want the government to adopt. But the way we have to counter this is, as Simantiji said, that we should have a common school, an All India Forum for Right to Education, which we have now in 20 states, we have tried to build the movement. And we have been demanding a common school, completely publicly funded, quality education, free, quality and affordable, whether they are rich or poor, all children and all young people should have access to education at public investment. So that is very important. So unless we build a movement to a strong public opinion, there is a possibility, there is a context. A new education policy provides the context and a reference point. I think except building a strong movement, and civil rights movement has to take right to education as a part of its agenda. And I think the civil rights movement and the social movements, the Dalit and Adivasi movements, women's movement, I think all movements now, it's time that they put education on their agenda and demand for education, quality education for all the children of India. I think that's the only way we can build the counter.
There was this question on foreign universities being encouraged to start branches in India, and therefore what is likely to happen?
Yeah, the thing is that we all know that there already are various laws, both state government and national laws, that even if you have a crore of rupees today, you can start a private university. So, you know, the kind of universities that are going to start on a large scale. So very few meritorious universities will come physically. And anyway, even if they do come, the national education policy does not mention the word reservation. Even when caste is mentioned, as Dr. Hargopal said, it's mentioned only about scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. Caste as an issue that is so volatile in our country is not even taken notice of in the new education policy. So reservations are not possible in any other private university, leave alone their local or foreign. And so what you will have are basically higher education polytechnic shops that are there for profit.
Now, foreign universities like corporate capital, they have been pressurizing it for quite some time. In fact, during the Congress regime itself, 2009-2014, if you look at the history of education, 6 bills were there before the parliament, structural adjustment on education. Kapil Sibal was trying to push, and one of the bills was the foreign universities bill. In fact, when I attended All India Vice Chancellor Conference, Kapil Sibal came and said, one of the American university presidents came and asked him, when are you starting, when will bill be passed? And Kapil Sibal tells 400 vice chancellors of the country that I had to hang my head in shame. This country will not progress. This was the thinking. So the foreign universities, when they come, that they come with their own agenda and foreign capital. On the one hand, we talk of Atmanirbharta, and then you talk of foreign capital and foreign universities. They will come and they will start this market, because there is a potential market in India. That's the reason why they are interested. And the foreign, the public policy already started tailoring itself to the needs of the foreign capital, because this foreign universities bill and 4 years degree course in the Delhi University, which was a big disaster, was on the demand of the foreign university, because 4 years is the graduation in America. And we have a 3 years graduation. That's why in this report, 4 years is the graduation. The 4 years of graduation is largely because they become on par with the American student. When foreign university come, they are qualified to join American universities. Our 3 years graduate will not be eligible. So already policy document is dovetailing itself to the needs of the foreign capital and demands of the foreign capital. But you talk of Nalanda, Takshashila, great traditions of education, and now you talk of foreign universities. And on the one hand, indigenization, ultra-nationalism, then you know this global capital and you know foreign universities. I don't know how they reconcile these two, you know, I mean, policies in two different directions.
There's one question about in the report, there's mention of the SCDGs, but they don't mention SCST. They say socially and economically disadvantaged groups. Mm-hmm. The real effort seems to be to do away with the reservation.
Yeah, right. So all the socially economically vulnerable groups are clubbed into socially economically I'm forgetting the full form right now, but the different histories and the different situations, the different locations of all these groups, whether they are Dalits or Muslims as minorities or various tribal groups across the country, are clubbed into one. And that is where this whole issue of even reservation comes in. There is the linkages to higher education and provision of reservations, the right of youth in universities, is that is why not being discussed at all by clubbing everybody together. Socially, economically disadvantaged.
In fact, for a very long time, we were using socially, educationally backward. Economic factor was not there. Socially backward and educationally backward. That was the expression for the reservation. But now by bringing economy, so what they bring in is the whole concept. Because a poor Brahmin child and a poor Dalit child are not comparable. Although economically they may belong to the same category, but there is a social advantage of a Brahmin child and definitely the way a Dalit child is treated outside, the way he is discriminated, that takes away the self-confidence. The upper caste have at least some self-confidence. So therefore, it was socially, educationally backward, but now they are bringing socially, economically backward. So the economic variable is brought back. And therefore, now they will treat a Brahmin child and a Dalit child on par as far as this, their background is concerned, which I think is negating the very principle of reservation.
There's also a mention made by Lalita Ramdas on how we should explore the possibilities of interventions at various levels. And also she is raising the issue of how they will teach ancient Indian culture. And we should actually explore using the constitution as the core source of values.
I think the way they define knowledge, yeah, if you look at the knowledge, the type of scholars or intellectuals that the report mentions is entirely from a Brahminical class. But they do not mention Buddha, Jain, Bhakti movement, Lokayats, you know, I mean, Charuvakas, and the entire freedom tradition, Gandhi, Tagore, they don't figure in. Therefore, the conception of knowledge is the Brahminical knowledge. And if you look at the higher education, they want the super intellectuals. So it's a pyramidal structure. As you move to the higher education, they make it very broad. Technology people should be exposed to the social science people should be exposed. Students should be prepared for 3 to 4 professions, not one profession. So that becomes at the top, at the tip. At the lower level, at the 8th standard or 3rd standard, you drop out and you go for a vocational occupation. So this type of supra intellectuals who dominated the Indian society for a very long time, the document again, you know, brings back that type of a small elite at the top and a broad base where you have again occupational, vocationally educated, you know, I mean, skill based, but because they make a distinction between skill and education. They don't talk of education, they are talking of skill. But the education is the first. Kothari Commission said up to 10th class it should be compulsory for all children because they should be educated. Then you can go for a skill. But before you are properly educated, you go for a skill. That means you are not an enlightened citizen. So the another functions of education is to produce enlightened citizenry with skills. But the skill-centric thinking is to put the child into the work force without properly the thinking, proper critical abilities, reasoning, and reflective abilities. You know, if you produce again, you are not producing citizenry. The citizenry will be very passive participants in democracy. That I think is the catch in this whole strategy that we have to decode and understand that very critically.
Yes, essentially based in the construct of knowledge economy that we need to go into, which looks at its all management kind of a paradigm that looks at redundancy as the main principle, that you take what you want, when you use it and you're not useful to you, you throw it out. And so as Professor Hargopal mentioned, it essentially has to be a pyramid, because only those in Seattle or places like that, or you know, in privileged places, are the knowledge creators, and the rest are the monkey army factory, essentially.
Sorry. The shift in balance of power in the sphere of education in favor of the center, to the detriment of states, in fact, is part of a larger process of structural transformation of the Indian state, which is undergoing right now. Subversion of quasi-federal structure in favor of a unitary is part and parcel of that sinister project. Any comments on that?
Yeah, I think that's from Shukla. And I think from the Finance Commission onwards itself, this kind of a thing is so. And when we looked at the budget, a lot of things are related with these certain kind of fields like education, where it's a concurrent responsibility. And when it's very much a larger problem, both in decision making, as it's revealed in the national education policy, as well as in the regular plan policies, where first the center gives grants, expects the state to contribute, and the state situation is not the same. So the state contributes according to its own economic means. And so finally, these sectors are emaciated. In the report, we also talk about how federalism is totally, attacked by these exams that are being compelled to be held by the central government, and the court ruling in their favor. Even the fee issue that the parents finally went to Supreme Court, and the stay that the High Court had on the fee rise issue in favor of the management is still supported by the SC. So, of course, yeah, this is a centralization in a very obvious manner.
There's one comment which says the NEP has made the RTE redundant, sir.
Yeah, I think this document does not mention to RTE at any point. And what is going to happen, whether they will bring any amendment to the constitution, because now it's a constitutional right. And even reservation, for example, it's all provided by constitution. So if this policy has to be enforced, it involves several amendments to the constitution, including the right to education concept. How are they going to, because they have a majority, maybe if they are very keen, they may push through, because they are taking education policy very seriously. They want to implement from the coming academic year, and Prime Minister himself made day before yesterday, very serious observations on education. That means how serious they are about enforcing this policy document, I think, is very obvious. But while constitutional stumbling blocks are there, but now with a pliable judiciary, we really don't know how the judiciary is going to stick to its own earlier judgments, whether the judiciary and the executive will join together to make several amendments. I think it's something which we have to wait and see. But there will be constitutional hurdles to push through this policy.